surrounded them. What if they want to be a chef? They go to culinary school, you know? And in your world, that's not college, but somebody else's world, that is college. Yeah. But it's all out there.
Remember Brewster's Million?
My youngest is going to be a chef, by the way. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, remember Brewster's Millions?
Yeah, Brewster's Millions, right? Mm. Great movie. Yeah. That's just a movie, dude. It's not reality. Yeah, okay.
So you have appointed a Mufti for your trust, let's just say.
Yeah.
And by the time you are dead, your Mufti is also dead.
We get this question. Are you saying? Yeah.
I'm just saying. So what will happen then?
There'll be more. Your religion's been around for a long time. I think you're okay.
Can you have a backup Mufti
we don't just name him. We say you select a Mufti, whoever it is, of any Islamic center. And then if there's a dispute with somebody in your family over it, they select a Mufti. It just has to have that qualification.
I see.
Okay. That's the whole idea. Somebody learned, educated in Islamic law. That's the key. It doesn't have to be Mufti.
Oh, so you can specify criteria. Whoever passes that criteria will be your assignee?
No, actually, I have the all. It means complete 6 calculation how to distribute as per the Quranic verses, ayat number 11 and 12. And we have practiced this 20 years in Dubai. By the Islamic court.
Yeah.
So I can give you clarity your own this question, because this question will come up in your mind, having the property possession and distribution over here and Islamic value. So both I can reply. Let them finish first.
Yeah.
I'll give you a question, reply to your old question.
You can pick any Mufti you want. But to acquire that title, there's certain things that person had to done and accomplished, right?
So the easy way would just to say a reputable double ikhtar.
Those are my clothes.
Time to.
So maybe you put it up on your shirt and might be.
You think it's better this way?
I can share the mic.
Yeah, so since, Mufti's are disposable or expendable, so. You can appoint a reputable double ikhtar. Right, and that would suffice then. So any reputable doubt, there definitely would be something existing, inshallah, to the end of time. And that will take care of your need, inshallah.
The question, is that going to press? Okay, I'll come up and ask the question. That'll make it easier.
The question is, does the Mufti get to override the state of Washington law?
Yeah, in a trust,
yes.
Okay. In a will? No. Yeah. And that's one of the things I'm really excited about that we put together over the past 2 months, is this dispute resolution mechanism. A trust is private. The terms of the trust, there's certain requirements it has to have, but beyond that, it's kind of a blank piece of paper. So what we've crafted is this. The other estate plans that I've done have an arbitration provision where, under the rules of United States arbitration as set forth in New York and stuff. Well, what I've done for you, along with Mufti Suhail, is we've crafted a dispute resolution unique to Islamic law. That's the cool thing about it. You don't get that with a will, but you do get it with the trust. With the trust that I created. Not any trust, but not the trust on the internet. Not there. Our thing, is there. Is there a question in the back? No? We good? Okay. Yeah.
A question about the taxes, state taxes or debt taxes.
Yeah.
So you said when a home gets transferred to the heir, the strike price is that market price at that time.
Correct.
$700,000.
Correct.
Now, does that count against that $4 million at $700,000 before it?
Correct.
$700,000.
Correct. It's the gross. So if it's worth 700 and you owe 695, it still counts as 700. Yeah. Okay. Do you want to take a? It seems like we're on a roll. If you want to take a break, we can take a break, because I'm getting ready to talk about how trusts work. So it's up to you. I guess it's up to your call.
We should just continue.
We're going to continue. Okay.
Can I? Is it based on where the basis person dies?
Towards the end.
Yes.
Hmm?
Towards the end. Right at the end, inshallah.
Yeah.
Can you repeat the question, please?
So he said on the tax, is it based on where you reside? And the answer is yes. And you know, sooner or later you're going to hate asking me questions. But here you go. Here's the answer. If you live in Washington, then we count your worldwide assets, but it's prorated. So let's say, and I'm going to use big numbers so that, you know, this applies to everybody. So let's say that your Washington assets are $1 million and that you own other property in another state and that's $100,000. We count the assets in the other state as well, so your gross estate is $1,100,000. However, it's only based on the percentage of the Washington is the tax. And since you're under the $2 million, you're okay. In Oregon, and I'm not gonna ask for a show of hands, but I'm just gonna give you a warning. If you own real estate in Oregon, you need to call me. Here's why. Oregon's limit is $1 million. Oregon counts your worldwide assets. Period. Ding. So here's how the law changed. Nike is based in Oregon. So what was happening was you'd have somebody in Washington or Texas or wherever, and they owned some shares of Nike, and they died. And then Oregon would say, hey, you own Nike stock, and that's in Oregon, and you owe us some money. And our limit's $1 million, and we count your worldwide assets. Which caused some problems, because, well, if you why would you buy Nike stock? If you had more than $1 million, why would you ever own Nike stock? You would buy Microsoft or something else cool, right? You'd own Amazon. Anything but Nike, because you'd write a check to Oregon. So they changed the law a little bit, but here's the kicker. What they said is, look, if you own personal property in Oregon, that doesn't count. But if you own real estate, then everything counts. So if you live in Washington and you own Nike stock and you die, you're good, okay? But if you own any dirt of any kind in Oregon and you die, and you have more than $1 million in assets, they count your worldwide assets. Whether you've actually gone to Oregon or not gone to Oregon, it counts. You owe a check. I figured out how to fix it. Here's how you fix it. LLCs are personal property, like Nike stuff, right? So if you got some property in Oregon, what we do is we move the dirt into a Washington LLC. Your trust owns the Washington LLC. You die, or you're incompetent or whatever, it's in your trust. You avoid probate, and you do not own any real estate in Oregon. You own an LLC, personal property, like Nike stock. Now that LLC might own some expensive real estate, or inexpensive real estate, I don't care, but it owns the dirt. So we avoid Oregon tax. So I'm not asking for a show of hands, but if you have friends or family, or if it's you, dude, you gotta give me a call. Okay.
I have a follow-up question. Yeah. Are there any tax, say for states, like if Washington is taxing more, are there any other states that could tax less?
Each state can make their own estate probate tax. There are very few states that have it. Washington's one of them. Oregon is another. Idaho does not, Nevada does not, California does not, Arizona and Nevada, none. So what we do is, and I don't want to get too far afield, but when you have assets more than $2 million, as long as you're south of $4 million, we can manage things in the state of Washington and you're fine. Once you get north of $4 million, when you get between the $4 and $7 million range, $7 million is the sweet spot, what you do is when one spouse dies, then the other spouse should consider relocating to Nevada, because Nevada doesn't have any state income tax, and they also have the federal $5.35 million exemption. So by doing that, changing your residence, I can save you $565,000. So if you like money, it's a good way to go. But each state does it, it's just you happen to live in a state where we do. Yeah. Any questions on this one? No?
Question. So you talked about the state tax. Is there a federal too? Or?
Yeah. The federal level is $5.35 million per person. So if you live in Nevada, you can shelter $10.6 million, husband and wife. But because you live in Washington, it's $2 million, use it or lose it. So, and the reality is that it's an unlimited transfer among spouses. So I'll give you an example. Bill Gates dies. He can leave $2 million to whoever he wants in Washington State, use it or lose it exemption. The other billions of dollars could go to Melinda, his wife, or whoever he wanted. You avoid tax. All the transfers to the spouse is unlimited. So he can't leave it to, I mean, there's certain charitable deductions and things like that. Let's say he left it all to his spouse. But now spouse has a problem. Spouse can only give away $2 million. So if you do things correctly the right way, upon the death of the first spouse, we're usually good. But that's when we got to start doing something else for the surviving spouse. Okay. Any question?
Do the trustees need to be over here in the United States, or can they be in India?
They can be anywhere you want. That's another cool thing about it. Yeah, I have clients all over the world. London, Dubai, some in Pakistan. And that's one, I mean, there's a lot of great things about the internet, but that's one of the great things about the internet, in email and video conferencing and Skype and all those different things. It makes it a lot easier to administer a trust located in Washington with somebody who's in a different country or even a different state. I don't care if you're, 50 miles from here or 5,000 miles from here. Yeah. Any question? Yeah?
Can that trustee misuse the trust before the before overrides the trust is incapacitant? Okay, because you mentioned that's effective immediately.
Right.
So can the trustee misuse it before it should be used?
The successor trustee, or because you're the trustee. If you create a trust, you're the trustee. If you and your wife create a trust, you're the trustee. The successor trustee is only if you become incompetent, then it goes to the, or you die. So,
the person who will be managing the wealth.
Yeah. So it's a little bit of a checks and balances when it comes to that. I can tell you it rarely happens. I mean, I've been doing this 25 years, I had it one time. And it gets caught pretty quickly because they have, when the successor trustee kicks in, they have to provide an accounting to all the heirs, all the beneficiaries. And believe it or not, when your name is a beneficiary, for some reason you start caring a lot about money. So they ask for the accounting, and it's pretty easy to catch. I mean, bad things can happen in anything, I mean, with an executor of a will through a probate, bad things can happen. The successor trustee of a trust, sure. But here's the deal. Pick somebody you trust. You pick. Don't let the state of Washington pick for you or some other creditor or whatever. You pick. Pick somebody you trust.
Like what if someone picks his wife and then a divorce happens?
Well, then it's the trust is not nullified, but the power, and it says that specifically in the powers of attorney as well, then terminates upon dissolution. For both, goes both ways.
A question following up on that trustee being in another country.
Living somewhere else, yeah.
Yeah, but does that person has to come into Washington to execute that trust, or
no.
Physical presence, is that necessary?
No. I just did one, trustees in Spain. So the trust sold real estate here. We FedExed the documents to Spain, Madrid. They signed them, they notarized them according to Spanish law, sent it back here, recorded it.
Who did the things on their behalf here?
Attorney.
Who did the attorney did the stuff on their behalf? Like, did they thrive the attorney?
The successor trustee hired me.
From overseas?
Yes.
Okay.
From overseas.
So the government will notify them overseas initially?
No, the government doesn't notify them. The government has nothing to do with it.
So you mentioned after the person dies, they have to file his will. So how will they get to know they are overseas?
Oh, that's if you open a probate. If you don't do a trust, then yeah.
Oh, okay.
If you don't do a trust, then sure. Then that makes it more difficult on multiple levels.
Gotcha.
Because when you have an executor who's not residing in Washington, what they do is they appoint a local agent, which is typically me. But we can still get to the same steps, but that's through a probate. You got
so
to hire a lawyer.
Probate is more like an inheritance, but trust is more like a company. You're sharing with company.
Yeah, that's the concept. I would not describe it that way because that's not exactly accurate, but that's a concept. It's its own separate entity. It owns bank account, and that's actually where we're going. Okay. You want to keep going? You want to say something or no? No? Shocking. Yes, sir.
In the bill, we are considering the entire list of property and assets, or each individual property and assets has different will. What I mean,
one will.
One will for entire bill.
Yeah. That you can have as many trusts as you want, just like you can have as many businesses as you want or companies as you want, to use your analogy. But you can only have one will.
So I just list all the items?
No, you don't list anything. Well, you can, sure, but it's not required. That's the difference between making a trust and a will. With a will, you just have to make a will and say, I leave, you know, percentages this way or property to somebody, but you don't have to transfer anything into it. With a trust, same concept, but you've actually got to move the title into the box. And that's where we're going next. But you only have one will. That's it. Yes, sir.
Suppose I have some jewelry in my locker.
Where's your locker? No. Well,
Chris, can you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, if he has some jewelry in a locker, you know, and a lot of people have that kind of stuff, right? I mean, they've got important items that they don't want the world to know about, and it happens to be kept someplace, and that's fine. What we do in the trust is I actually give you we keep talking about. But seriously, buy a longer cord.
Let's see if we can pull it out.
No. It's funner this way. So this is like an estate plan that I do for you. There's a transfer of personal property, and you don't have to specifically say it. It says jewelry, furniture, works of art, gold bullion, artifacts, whatever. A blanket statement that everything is in the trust. You don't have to specifically identify it. However, on the next page, you can leave specific items to specific people and you can change your mind as often as you like. So you don't have to, because, you know, people like the idea of privacy. So you fill that out in private. I don't need to know about it. The government doesn't need to know about it. You and your successor trustees are the only ones who know. That's a cool thing.
So to open up a trust, you need to be in the same state? Can I open up a trust in Arizona, for example?
Yes, I'm licensed in Arizona as well.
Okay.
Yeah, I can do them for Washington, Oregon, Arizona, and Idaho.
Sure. So I live in California, I can open up a trust in Washington, you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it'd be a Washington trust. Or you could hire a California lawyer and do a California trust. Okay. You can do both. But if you own real estate, do one or the other. So like a Washington trust can own California assets, vice versa. You could have a California trust own Washington assets.
Is there a state that's best for opening up a trust?
Washington. No, actually we are. I say that kind of joking. But we are because we have the highest level of requirements for a trust to qualify.
Okay.
So the trust that I draft, the trust that are properly drafted in Washington are valid in all 50 states.
Okay.
That's not necessarily true of a different state where the standards are different, like maybe Louisiana or something. You know, but
okay.
Well, we have the highest standard.
Just a follow-up question on that. If I move to another state, do I continue with the same trust or
yes.
Do I have to re-register it in the new state?
This is good. Yep.
Christopher, can you repeat questions?
Yeah, he said if he does a Washington trust and he moves to another state, does he have to do a trust in that other state? And the answer is no. You're good. And one of the other things about a trust is they don't, and this might gonna offend some people, I'm sorry in advance. It doesn't expire just because we say it expires, right? So when you make a trust, it's good from now on. It doesn't just someday become outdated and unsupported by Microsoft just because they choose not to support it anymore. Sorry.
You're not getting any more business
credit. I know. we're friends, though. We're talking honestly. I'm just saying. But the trust is good from now on. If you want to change it, you can change it. What a lot of people do, though, is if they move to a different state and it's been a while, what they might do is they might update their powers of attorney or their healthcare directive for that particular state. So like the healthcare directives and stuff for Washington are different from Oregon. They're different from Idaho. They're different from Arizona. The trusts are pretty similar, but you might want to update something else. Like Washington, for example, and we're going to talk about it in a minute. January 1st, we changed all of our power of attorney stuff. So it's different than it was in December. And ours are different from Oregon, Idaho, and Arizona. So frequently people will update and change that type of thing, but leave the trust alone. I'm going to start in the back and I'll work for it. Yeah.
Can you have a will and a trust?
Yes, that's exactly what we do. But the architecture of it, and we're going to get to this. The will is there as a safety net in case you goof up. Then we can go probate that one asset you forgot to put in there. But we're heading that way. Okay. You can only have one will. So we've addressed that. So we can only have one will. What I say is you should check. So let's say you did a Washington trust with me and all that, and we did it. It can own foreign bank accounts. It can also own foreign real estate. What you should do is take your new super cool, you know, trust estate plan to a lawyer in that other country and say, is this good enough? And if they're based on English law, you're probably fine. So I can't speak to that because I sincerely don't know. But the roots of what we do in Washington and in the United States is English rooted. And so what I've seen, you know, I know it's good in England. I know it's good in Australia. You know, I know it's good in India. But beyond that, I don't know because I haven't had any experience with the personal review. We got two people. There's one right behind me.
So if I have a trust, do I still need to create a will?
Yes. Yeah, it's a tool in your tool shed because stuff happens. And I'll explain. You need to have a trust, a will, a financial power of attorney, a healthcare power of attorney, a HIPAA healthcare release, a designation of guardianship for you, a designation of guardianship for your minor kids. I think you need all of those things because all of those tools address different issues in your life that you're going to use at some point.
If your trust is attested by the UA, Indian consulate here, this trust will be applicable legally in India.
Right.
And same thing, if you have a property in England, if you have attested your trust by the British consulate here, it will be applicable legally in England.
There you go. International lawyer. There you go. Total bonus. Yeah. Didn't pay for it, just got it.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah,
just a quick question. So you mentioned about the assets in different states, and if I have an asset in different state, I need to have a trust from that state as well.
No. I said you need to have a trust that owns title to the real estate in the other state to avoid probate in that state.
Okay.
So if you have a Washington trust and you own...
That's a five.
That's good. But if you own real estate in California, you want it owned by the Washington trust. If you own property in Nevada, you want it owned by the Washington trust. In Idaho, Montana, wherever, you want it owned by the Washington trust. That way you avoid probate in those states.
So for example, a bank account is a trust. Is an asset.
Is an asset.
And it's owned by a bank in a different state, right?
Yes.
So if I open the trust in this state, that's sufficient, right?
As long as you title that bank account in this trust,
so
not in your name.
Right. So if anything happens after I create the trust, like open new accounts, get a new property in the future, whether it is in this state or overseas, I need to keep updating the trust.
Correct.
Right.
Not changing the terms of the trust.
Updating.
Adding stuff to the trust. Okay. Yeah, you can, and that's exactly where we're going. That's the next slide coming up.
Actually, this relates to this. So, and also the law. So you mentioned like in January something happened. So
yeah.
I guess the assumption is when you sign a trust or create a trust, then it locks in the whatever the applicable law at that time, right?
Correct.
So, I mean, the trust could be used 20 years from now. Law could be different, but
correct.
It's the law will be used that when you sign it.
Yeah.
But what about, like he mentioned, that you're adding or like you're doing some amendment 10 years from now,
yeah.
then... Are you then falling under the law applicable at that time, or is it still
you
the
keep the original trust date?
Original trust date. Okay.
Yeah, it's called a restated trust. And if any, and what we're talking about, if any of you already have a trust or estate plan, what we would do is we would update it, revise it according to what we're doing now. It's just, we keep the original trust date. So if you did it in 2001 or 1994 or 1950, whatever, we just keep that original date. We give, because you when you amend a trust, you can amend one word, you know, but you can also amend all the words. So what we do is we amend all the words and we give it the new 2017 language. Yes, sir?
If you have several different properties, does it make sense to have each one in an LLC, separate LLC?
Different question, and I have a different opinion on it. It's management of risk. So if you have single family homes, and this is my personal opinion, if you have single family homes, I say it's okay to have it all in one LLC because the real risk is not that great. Now, if you are buying real estate, rehabbing real estate, and then selling that real estate to make money, I would do each project in a separate LLC to keep your risk segregated from your main assets. If you had a multifamily home, and by multifamily, I mean more than five people. So if you're at 80 units or 16 units or 120 units or whatever, I would have that in a separate LLC because multifamily, just having that many people in that small of an area creates unique set of problems and unique sets of risks. So in that situation, I would have that in a different LLC. But if you had single family, freestanding homes, I say put them all in one and just buy insurance. It's a cheaper, easier way to go. But that's only my opinion. Your risk level might vary. You know, I have some people who have eight rental homes and they're all in eight different LLCs because that's what they want and that's good for you. But that's not my personal opinion.
All right, let's do this. Since we're in a break, the plan is to break at 4%. Could we do one more segment before we break?
I would love to do one more segment.
Let's move on and we can take questions later.
Okay, here we go. Well, and this is perfect. So here's the the disadvantage. So all good, one bad, right here. There you go. It requires you to transfer assets into the trust. So you got to create the trust, and then you got to move stuff into the box. It just doesn't happen automatically. You got to move the bank. You got to title the bank account in the trust. You got to execute a deed from your name to you as trustee of the trust. You got to change the ownership of your stock account to the trust. But you have to actually do something to move the assets into the trust. Okay, so here's the next segment. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna do these out. We've already done this. I'm gonna come back to this because we're gonna take a break. So I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna tell you how it works. Might as well give you the solution before you go have snacks. Here's how we work, okay? We've got you, we have Islamic law, we've got your parents, if they're alive, you've got a spouse, if you're married, you've got children, you've got siblings, brothers and sisters, okay? We have title to assets, and now we know that everything has title, right? So we have bank accounts, what I've been talking about. Personal property, you know? Stuff in a locker to be disclosed later, right? Cars, that says cars. There's a bracket there, it says cars. And real estate, which we've been talking about. So this is you. this is you, and this is stuff you got. So here's how it works. You create a box, an entity, separate from yourself. It's governed by a trust agreement. And that trust agreement identifies the terms of how these assets will be managed. If I'm alive and competent, what do we do? If I'm alive and incompetent, what do we do? If I'm married and I die, what do we do? If we both die, what do we do? Okay. If we have a dispute, what do we do? That's what the trust agreement's all about. So you are the trustee. That's like the president of the corporation. You are the person that manages the assets. Separate property remains separate property. So if you are married and you create a trust together and husband moves an asset into the trust, it's still separate property in the event of divorce. If husband moves property out of the trust, it's still a separate property. Same is true. If wife moves property into the trust, she can move assets out. It retains its character. The trust specifically says that separate property remains separate property. You pick a successor trustee and a backup trustee. So if something were to happen to you where you weren't able to manage your assets anymore, you pick somebody, hopefully that you trust, to manage the assets for the benefit of your beneficiaries. And you might be the beneficiary if you're alive and incompetent. They manage the assets for your benefit, or your spouse, or your children, or your parents, or your brothers and sisters. You designate your beneficiaries according to Islamic law. So it's viewed as your last act on earth, so you want to make sure it complies with Islamic law. So you can designate, the state of Washington doesn't care if you give 100% one way or 100% another way. The state of Washington doesn't care if you give 1/6 to your parents if they're alive or not. The state of Washington doesn't care if you give twice as much to your eldest son or not. The state of Washington doesn't care, but you care. So in the trust agreement, you can designate your beneficiaries, and the unique thing, the unique opportunity you have is you have Mufti Suhail, who I've learned a lot in the past few months from, about the gifting requirements. Muhammad Sheikh and I've known Sheikh for 20 years, wonderful person, wonderful family. We tried to do his estate plan many years ago, and we worked on it for 9 months trying to get it right, and we came close. We won.